That takes
is talent. Also known as a long range rim job. And, you know, and it says in a sentence, if you were to, just so you can really know what it means.
Yeah, can you use it in a sentence?
Yeah, in a sentence. Yeah, actually, yeah, actually, this is from, this was submitted by Rim Jim Salabim in May 27th, 2011. He said, I was watching the BYU game while Gene Simmons gave me a rimmer for that. Welcome to the Dylan Joe Basement Podcast. Every week, same hosts, same podcast, same way to listen and watch the podcast on Spotify or YouTube. I'm your host, Dylan, and
I'm your other host, Joe. To start me off, I wanted to quote Aldo Raine from the film Inglourious Basterds, says, there's a number of things wrong with fighting in the basement. Number one, you're fighting in a basement. And today we're going to be fighting in a basement on the Dylan and Joe Basement Podcast.
Here we go. And to, I think Black History Month is what, next month?
Yes, it is. And it was Martin Luther King Day this Monday, actually.
Yeah, we've got a whole nother fucking plan for February that we're not going to tell you about yet. It is another, it's another month for us.
Yep.
We have a whole theme. But we want to get Black History Month out of the way because it's an important fucking month.
It wasn't planned that way, but I'm glad we get to basement.
But here we are. Yeah, we got arguably the most, well, I mean, actually, quite frankly, I'm not going to do everyone injustice here. One of the most badass dudes in the 1800s.
Who, easily.
Easily. Easily. But a lot of people out there were badass as well.
True.
And I definitely know his first name, and I'm going to let you pronounce his last name. Because I'm not French, so, and neither is he. So
neither is he, exactly right.
So today we are talking about Tom.
We're talking about Tom Molineaux in the history of bare-knuckle boxing, the first American bare-knuckle boxing champion, it's a mouthful, to make it over to England to compete for the world championship of bare-knuckle boxing at the time. That's what we're talking about today.
Talking about today, and you can see in Joe's right behind Joe is Tom on the left there. And
yeah, I'll talk now just so the Zoom can see me. But yeah, that's a portrait someone did of the Tom's most famous fight, which we will talk about as we roll through the podcast.
Yeah, and it's only requirements are that you don't wrap your hands and you make sure that you wear old English navy pants.
yeah, pants, you know, those pantaloon style ones, that they don't make it past your knee very much because you got to wear socks underneath, which they did still wear socks in the fight. I love that. No shirt, but you got to wear socks.
Yep, get those pants gotta wear up. Socks. And it looks like I think you have to wear dress shoes.
Oh, well, yeah, well, that's shoes, you know, they didn't that's all they had. It was either you wore shoes or sandals, so they were to choose to wear shoes.
Yeah
which we would say today is leather dress shoes that can't be comfortable to move around in, never mind fight a man.
Well, here's the thing, I mean, I do know a lot about shoes. Well,
yes, you do.
I have a lot of shoes, and no one's really made a leather shoe like that for like daily driving, you know, like,
mm-hmm.
like, oh, this is the shoe I wear every day, like the Converse or the you're an Adidas guy.
Yep.
Converse, Vans, Airwalks, fucking.
Sure.
What's that other thing people do? The activities.
Reebok pumps.
Reebok pumps. CrossFit shoes. Hiking
Air
shoes.
Air Jordans.
Air Jordans. That would be more basketball related, but I appreciate it.
Oh, Crocs.
Crocs, definitely. I'm wearing Crocs right now for sure. Yeah. But no one's making like a leather shoe like that actually is like works for walking and running and going to Target.
No, because leather shoes are really bad for that. That's why we've designated them to dress shoes. And in the past, they didn't have any options for, you know, the plastic and rubber and textile shit we can put together now. I think they would have liked to wear sneakers for this boxing match if I gave them the option. Unfortunately for them,
yeah,
there was no such option.
It's true. It's also, I know I get that this is a boxing match, but it is definitely too bad that you don't get to get kicked in the face with one of those, because that would be a real whole
set of memories. For sure. Yeah, that'll slap you into next Tuesday. Boot heel of my size number nines, which would be massive in the year 1775, where we start our story here.
They don't have size 9 in 1775.
Oh, they do, but people's foot/shoe sizes were a lot smaller in the past. We're breaking records every year. Gotta love eating enough food and having enough nutrients to grow bigger. Yeah, a lot of high school girls' feet are larger than, on average, than a lot of adult men's feet in the 1700s. Very strange.
Look, they'd like fall over, especially if you're on a ship.
Yeah, exactly. You need those big paws. I mean, they were still adult men feet, but yeah, they're just a lot smaller. Like, they have to make new shoe sizes larger every year because the average foot size of adults is growing worldwide, even in third world countries.
Wow, that's something to know. I do have to bring this up. I know we have a lot to talk about with our friend Tom here.
Yeah, but, sure. Good.
But there's this whole big thing right now that's like, our feet versus caveman feet. And like some dude decided.
Right. Well, there's a whole big thing that is going on with you about it. I think it's fascinating, but I don't know if it's reached the public zeitgeist as much as.
So we'll tell you guys
getting back to caveman feet. We talked about it in a previous podcast. So I'm glad that you hit on it.
Yeah. One dude, he decided not to wear shoes for a year and just do his fucking life and his toes.
Yeah. This is in our podcast.
Okay. Well, you know what? I'm not being paid to remember everything.
I know you're not. I don't mind if you want to expound on it, but you definitely can't tell the story again.
I watched some of our podcasts, older ones, and I'm like, I can't believe I fucking said that. So everybody, whether I remember it or not.
It's not a problem at all. Yeah.
I don't even know what the fuck I'm coming out of my mouth.
You're the normal person who doesn't want to watch us talk over and over again. I'm the psycho who likes listening to it over and over again. That's why I remembered it, not because you should have remembered. It was weeks ago, probably a month ago by now.
Well, it's more fun to me for that to be like a year later and then watch it and be like, wow, I fucking said, I'm like, it's like a different person.
Sometimes. It's much better that way.
I agree. Actually said that. I'm like, this is crazy. I know sometimes there's a couple nicotine things and alcohol and
sure it happens
all that stuff
but that's not what is just because I went through the entire thing. That's why I remember it, but that's neither here nor there. Let's get into it. Let's get into Tom Molineaux and the history of
Tom Molineaux. So it's pretty much a fact at this point that he is born a slave, right?
That is right. Tom Molineaux, which makes it one of the best parts of his story, is that he started with less than nothing. He was in servitude. And he rises up through all that. But I wanted to start our story briefly on another person who was slightly ahead of him in the boxing game, just because when Molineaux's career takes off, he's the guy who takes him under his wing. So do you mind if I start briefly with the man who went on to be his Mr. Miyagi, his Mick, if it was Rocky? And that's,
you got it, man. Yeah,
that's Bill Richmond.
Bill...
Richmond, yeah.
Bill Richmond.
Richmond from Richmond Town, New York is what they call it now. I don't know if that was one of the more wealthy men in the town, but at the time he was born there, born into servitude, Bill Richmond grew up in Cuckoldstown, New York.
Great place. It's one of my favorite towns.
That's the name of the town. You can look it up.
Don't we know someone from there? Was it, is it Dom?
I know. Yeah, I know a couple people from there. They make it very clear.
They're from Cuckold. I know we know someone from Cuckold. We visited before.
Yeah, exactly.
I think actually it might be on my birth certificate. I have to look it up.
Oh, I can't imagine. You've been born there. I would feel so bad for you. But yeah, you can still look up today, Cuckoldstown, New York. It's, when you look it up on Google, it'll say Richmond Town, but Google knows what it used to be called before they changed the name. Exactly. Back before it had such implications, it was Cuckoldstown, New York.
Is that
where Richmond was born?
Is that when you grab like someone else's ball sack?
Oh no, it's when you sleep with someone else's wife and you watch it. When someone sleeps with your wife and you watch,
because you sit in the corner and
yeah, Yeah, that's what it is. Okay. Or I suppose it also works the other way, but there's a different word for that.
Yep. Okay. All right. Now we're on the same page. Okay. Glad to know.
So I thought that was a funny name.
Everyone probably learned something from there. I just thought sometimes you just call someone a fucking cuck because they're
being... Yeah. Well, that's the basis of it, though, being like, you're the kind of person who wants to sit in the corner and watch someone else get down to business while you just sit there.
Your wife. Which, yeah, totally.
Yep. Naming your town after that, I'm sure that the word came after the town was already named, but it's funny to think of a town that's run entirely by cucks and what a town like that would be like.
Yeah, another
even podcast. the mayor is like, I don't know, why don't you just tell me? I mean what do I know, you know?
Yeah, maybe we just have to talk about this another time, but I'm sure, but that would be funny. It probably there was a lot of people who were really into that there, and they're like, we're gonna call this new act of just staying in the corner watching.
Yeah, we're gonna name it after the town and the community,
railed by somebody else. After the town, man.
Yeah, it could have been called being Albany'd, but now it's called Cuckold because of that town.
Definitely funnier. So,
and that's what it is.
Carry on, let us know what's going on.
Sure. Yeah, so he was born and raised there. He worked, which at the time, the New York State had the most slaves per capita of any northern state. Yeah, until, you know, when that didn't happen anymore. And when he was the first notable story about the guy being a tough MF-er is that when he was 13, he was tasked to go get water for the horses. And when he was out getting water from the well, three British soldiers started giving him a hard time and talking smack to him and pushing him around. And as a 13-year-old boy, he beat the shit out of three British men who were soldiers. Two of them ran away and the other one hit the floor, and he supposedly didn't have a scratch on him. And after he was done, he went and grabbed the buckets of water and filled it up and walked back to the horse. Like, he just was like, made it part of his day. He's like, these guys are gonna mess with me, boom boom boom.
It happens. Yep.
Yeah. And it turned out that he actually had training within his community, because as we get into the history of bare knuckle boxing, the mentality on how to do it or how to fight in the street in general is different between communities. And that's why he was such a badass 13-year-old. That plus got to have some balls. I mean, I can't imagine going up against a couple of adult soldiers and just going like, yeah, the three of you, I'm 13, not a big deal, I'll take you down. And he did that. And he ended up, because he was so good at fighting for his owner against other slaves that were owned, which was a horrific practice that went on for years and years, where people would just pit them against each other. You don't have a choice.
Django thing to do, unfortunately.
It's like Django, exactly. Yeah. And it's not like they have an option. You have to fight anyways. It's just, would you want to live or die or not? And they try to be cute about it by, you know, offering them rewards and stuff if they won, to try to incentivize people. But this guy was a natural, and he got better and better at it. He was so good at beating the hell out of people that his owner actually put him up for the biggest fight of his life or anyone's life at the time. He puts him up against the best other fighter from some other sicko plantation named Abe. And the bet on the fight is $100,000 at the time. This is in 1760s in New England, or New York rather, America. Can you guess how much money that would be today?
I'm going to take a wild shot at this. So $100,000 in 1760s, you said?
That's right.
Let's throw out their number, like $76 million.
Okay, that is a lot. Yeah, you had the right idea. But yeah, it's $2 million. I mean, you know.
That's it? Oh, come on. No one's surprised about this. I am really... overshot that by a little bit.
You did, and that was on me because I left it up for,
maybe I was a little high, just
I left it up for debate there. But I mean, this is not this guy's full estate. He's betting this on one fight. He's betting $2 million on a fight between, wow. Yeah, and that's it. And but it was still enough that it was going to be, he's going to be financially ruined if he lost the fight. He was so
that's
confident.
Where the term cuck came from, because this fucking guy has obviously got some fucking,
he's cucked
shit going on, where he's got totally. He's not satisfied at bet. He's like, I gotta do something else to get hard. Like,
yeah, I have to bet, you know, the value of my entire estate, you know, to actually on a fight. Which he only put him up there because this other fighter Abe was so good that the guy was like, no one can beat him no matter what. And this guy's ego is so big, he's like, I got a guy who can't. Well, lucky for Bill Richmond, not only did he bet $100,000 on the fight. He also bet a purse for Bill of $500 if he won and his freedom.
Yeah.
Now that's some incentive if I ever did
here. Fucking deal. So you got to take some change, hit the road. And what's $500 worth back then? About $500,000?
Probably. Yeah, I didn't do the calculation on that.
I'm just taking the calculation for
It's probably, I mean, if you're adding it to that degree, it's at least $5,000, probably like 10 grand.
Yeah, yeah.
That's pretty good. That's some walking around money.
You can retire on that, honestly. Given the price.
And also Bill wasn't just a fighter, you know, who was, you know, picking plants in the meantime. He was learning the trades and how to build how to work with wood, which he goes on to do. But anyways, I don't mean to, you know, lay the pipe too quickly, but he fucking wins. He beats the hell out of the guy and he wins his freedom, and then off he goes and he decides, you know, America's not so great to people that are treated the way I was treated and had to fight tooth and nail my way out of bondage. So he goes to York, England, where he continues to get, you know, into fisticuffs. The difference between him and most other fighters at the time is that he had money. He was building cabinets for a living. He owned property. And most of the guys who are doing bare knuckle boxing are like dock workers or people without jobs. And they're mostly poor white guys in England who want to throw their fists around and act tough and try to make it out of the slums. This guy, he was already sitting high on the horse and he was beating the hell out of these guys. He was like, I don't care. I got money, but I'm really good at doing this. And I don't mind making some more money on the side. So I just love that notion of like a business owner going toe to toe with like a bunch of hoodlums to be like, yeah, I can take you guys. And he did. And he used to take people out left and right.
Awesome. And another difference between like where he fought and where he fought when he got there was they say things like, ah, oh, mate, I'm going to go put some shrimp on the barbie while we get.
Oh, no, that's Australia. Come on. Blimey. You got quite a fist on you.
Fist on you. You know, man, I hope my ancestors were part of that. And yours too. I mean, we're part of that.
Just across the little ocean there.
We're a bunch of Ireland salty old fishermen in England who or don't have jobs and go, well, just going to get in fights every whenever I can and get paid.
Yeah, just getting fights. They used to collect money around the docks, you know, all the workers be like, we'll pay the winners and the losers, and that'll guarantee the guys will fight and make some money, you know, not illegal.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's cool. I mean, there's rumor. I know I don't know what Collins means in Gaelic, but
I do.
But I do know that Reed is usually... Reed, brown, black, white, whatever, usually associated with jail. So maybe I just beat the shit out of people, or on the opposite end where I just got the shit kicked out of me and a fucking what kind of fish they usually eat there?
Oh, I don't know.
They eat like carp. Trout and carp.
Trout, yeah, yeah.
Something, I don't know.
I don't know, but you could be.
Cool, yeah, whatever. Yeah. So
you could be that. You could be ancestors of those very folks for sure. And also, the guy loved to flaunt it, which I love about him, where he was walking around. He loved, you know, flaunting his money, wearing nice suits and walking around town with a white lady on his arm. And those British stuffy guys from the early 1800s, they didn't much like that, but he didn't give a shit. He was like, fight me then.
Yeah, nothing you can do about it.
Nothing you can do about it.
You white cuck.
Yeah, exactly. And he knew he knows better because he came from cuckold town.
Maybe he's the one who brought it to England. He probably said, I'm from Cucksville.
Yeah, which was where all you belong.
And literally everyone there, it reminds me. You remind me of him.
Yeah. He named the town because everyone was the cuck to him. Exactly. He's like, that's where I'm from.
Yeah, I'm from that place, and those guys are fucking cocks.
Yeah, they're just like you guys, actually. They can't handle their own shit. I have to handle it for them. So, yeah, I love that. And I thought this would be a good time to at least define, like, what fighting was at the time, to be like, what are we talking about here? We're talking about fighting. And bare-knuckle boxing, it's, you know, even though it's still an underground thing, like, it wasn't sanctioned by government bodies. It wasn't like Sports Today where they're, like, you know, businesses run – that they're funded for millions and billions of dollars. It was an underground event, but it was looked down upon like as like polite society, but it wasn't illegal. It was like part of the national culture and people were involved in it. And it was like before things like soccer or cricket, England was about, this was the sport. I mean, this is the the beginning of the idea of the sweet science and all that stuff about boxing was this boxing. And it was before the gloves were involved, the bare knuckles. And it was before any safety measures were involved, because at the time, rules for bare knuckle boxing differ slightly in England and the United States. But here's the general idea. There's unlimited rounds. There's no end. And the timer is only for each round. There's no end of the fight. How you end the fight is either one guy gives up or one guy gets hit so many times he can't give up because he can't get up or talk. That's how the fights end. That's it. There's no end. Was
this when they thought you have to keep breathing because there's a candle inside of you?
Probably. They're probably still worried about that.
There's a lot of
snuff your light out.
Yeah, there's a lot of science that was a little weird. But what you said is, I mean, that's would be if we all were doing this when we were like 10 years old as boys, it would be the same rules.
Yeah, exactly. This is Lord of the Flies. Like,
oh, you either say you either get someone on their back and you go, give up, you pussy, fucking give up, you bitch. And they go, okay, because they're getting hurt. Or they're
that's exactly it.
Or they're just fucking out.
Because now in boxing, obviously, there's all kind of rules of what you can do. And this the rule was still for bare knuckle boxing, you can't use your legs, you can't kick anybody. But everything else, there was grappling, there was throwing. In America, they didn't call it boxing, they called it gouging, because it was so common to put your thumbs in people's eyes as part of the fight, or to grab their ears and rip them off. And that was all part of the fight. That wasn't like, you can't gouge his eyes. It's like, no, you're supposed to, because if you give up, you give up, and that's the fight.
Yeah.
The difference is in England, though, was that they had this idea called bottom, which it's all the old phrases are so funny. It's called bottom. And the better of a bottom you are, the better a fighter you are. And the idea of bottom is, how much can you take? So if you're the bottom, can you take a lot of punishment? That way you're a better fighter. So they thought you were more manly in England if you didn't move at all and you could just take punches to the face and just keep hitting back. Barely, just basically be like a robot where you just stand there. And they thought that was how you box. That's the name of the game. If you don't do that, you're a pussy. And that's how you fight. And that's it. So all of the English boxers would just kind of just stand there and just take hits and just try to slug away with no strategy at all, besides just being the toughest guy out there, which I kind of respect that. But the idea of being the best fighter, being standing still and getting hit a million times, I don't get how that makes you a tough big man. But that's what they had. That's called bottom. Fucking weird.
That is fucking weird. It's also a lot like the way that they fought wars. Everyone stand in line.
That is a perfect point. Please continue that. It's a perfect point.
Let's all stand in line and have rows and rows and rows. Then everyone shoots, and then whoever drops, drops. Whoever doesn't drop steps forward and does it again until, like, all right.
Yeah, this is the rules. Don't move.
It's like zero strategy. Just, this is what we're going to do. It's like,
exactly.
Just fucking fucked.
You're so right, because if they fight wars that way, why wouldn't they fight in the streets that way? But yeah, what a stupid idea. There's the rules. We'll stand still and we just take it. It's like, what the hell kind of strategy is that?
You ever been punched in the face?
Yeah, it's not pleasant. Only one time, though, like a real, like, trying to hurt me punch in the face. And it is a wake up call.
Sounds like a good story. I don't know about me, but.
No, I was at a crypto show. We got in an argument with another group of people.
Yeah,
I had to take one for the team. I didn't win anything, but you know, our side won because there's more of us.
It's awesome. Yeah. Yeah, it hurts.
Not fun. And that is something to behold, because the amount of punishment that these guys took, I even up against like the UFC and stuff like that, like it's no comparison, because there's no thought of safety whatsoever. It was just work them into the ground. Like, this is it.
I have read an interesting thing, though. I think your chance of severe injury is a little bit greater with gloves than it is with bare knuckle, because with bare knuckles, you are at significantly higher risk of hurting your hand.
That's right.
So hurting your hand. So if you hit someone not as hard in the side of the head, front of the head, wherever it is, their brain doesn't move as much in their skull. So their risk of serious brain injury is greater when it doesn't hurt the giver's hand at all.
So yeah, isn't that strange?
There's a weird level of, like, a light wrap is okay, but a full boxing glove might actually do more damage. Like,
yeah, and boxing gloves do weigh. They have weight to them.
Break your bones here, which is going to happen in these fights. that's like permanent damage that you can visibly see, but the brain isn't moving. I mean, these guys are all right around the board, all fucked, and they probably all died very young.
Right. No, but the point you're making is absolutely true, though, which I was unintuitive. I didn't know that going in. I was like, oh, these guys must have had all kinds of brain damage. But you're right. You have to have bare knuckles against people's skulls. Skulls are stronger than fingers. So that is true that they would get beat to a bloody pulp on the outside and it would ruin them. Like I said, they would still get destroyed. But as far as severe brain damage goes, it happens more with boxing gloves nowadays because it has a weight to them and it doesn't have the risk of breaking your hands. So you're right.
So you just go, I'm going to hit this fucking person as hard as I can because it's not going to hurt me at all.
Yeah, not going to hurt me at all. And I have the added weight of the glove and my full momentum to just crack their head around. And that is true that. And that's probably why these bare-knuckle boxing matches went so long, because I don't think these guys weren't strong, but the amount of time these guys took punishment, if it was in a ring today, there'd be 10 knockouts. I don't understand how it could make it that long. It
just, and if I was going to throw a punch at someone's face, hitting them anywhere above here is bad
in the news. Skull? Oh, yeah.
You break your something. And then,
yeah, you're going to break your whole hand.
You're just aiming for the nose and the jaw because the jaw moves a little bit.
Yeah, you want to hit the jaw and the nose. Yeah,
that's where you go. So these guys are generally just getting jaw and nose injuries and obviously black eyes. And
I'm sure the cauliflower ear, too, has got to be out of control. Punching the side of the head right in the ear, just blasting you.
Yep.
You're there.
Yep.
But yeah, so that was the whole idea of how they would fight. And like I said, it would only end when some person couldn't get up. Or the fight was called. The one degree that adds to the rules about not getting up is that when someone was knocked out, if they were conscious, they still had 30 seconds to get to a middle line in the fight, which is like the line of scrimmage. They call it the scratch. So if you were knocked out and you didn't know who you were or where you were, but you could stand up and make it back to the scratch, the fight's still on. You get 30 seconds to get up and touch that. That's like the only rule that kind of resembles a real sports rule. Besides that, go nuts.
Wow.
So all these English guys were into the whole bottoming, which I think they're still into, and they call it something else now. But this guy, Bill Richmond, who is like the teacher of our main character here, he was using the style of the stick and move, which all boxers do now. Slip the punches, play defensively. It's a marathon, not a sprint, and get it done. And they thought he was a wimp. They didn't like him. They didn't like him for being an African guy from America who's a great boxer. And they didn't much like him, but the numbers speak for himself. And this guy starts kicking the shit out of everybody who's just standing there, just trying to take punches, mate, being a tough guy. And the guy's moving around. They said that on average, he was about 30 to 40 pounds smaller than everyone he fought, but he won multiple fights over and over.
Have you seen the videos of, so Mike Tyson had a fight a couple months ago, and there's some videos of him just hitting, like the dude who's holding the thing, and he's just going.
Oh, yeah.
I think. And it's like, yo, I don't want to be anywhere near this.
Yeah, I think he's nearly 60 years old, Mike Tyson. Yeah. But he's just like, oh, yeah.
Imagine him saying, he goes, if right now someone was like, hey, Mike, I'm going to pay you or whatever, or hey, this is good. He would do it just for honor to do a bare knuckle fight.
Oh, yeah.
How about anyone else? Like, I mean, him versus, who's the Irish guy that everyone likes?
Conor McGregor.
Conor McGregor, yeah. I don't know, man. Dude, Mike Tyson hits twice as hard as that fucking guy.
No, yeah. I think McGregor would be, I mean, even he who's an egomaniac, he'd have to admit that if it was just a boxing match with Mike Tyson, bare knuckles, it'd be over. Mike Tyson's...
McGregor is like a piston.
His arm is a piston. It's a machine. It's not a piece of physical biomatter.
Yeah. Exactly. But he's a boxer and Connor's a everything guy. He's more,
Right. Like, yeah, he wants to get you on the ground and kicking.
Yeah, he's like hitting you with his fucking elbows or whatever. But overall, you don't want these guys fucking punching in the face.
No, and these guys we're talking about, they were all much closer to Mike Tyson than anyone in the UFC. I mean, they were all upper body. I mean, sure, they would grapple and they'd throw people, but there was no kicking and there was all just raining haymakers down. And haymaker wasn't even a crazy punch. It was like the main punch they'd throw. Just put all your weight and just go, ah! It's no strategy. It'd be unrecognizable versus modern boxing the way these guys are fighting. And even the reason why they have their stance and all the pictures, they put one arm close to the guard to their body and one arm up, is what you just said, Dylan, because you're much more likely to strike them in their squishy parts with your bare knuckles than hit them in the skull. And you can hit a guy in the skull and break your fingers and that might give him a big headache and he can't see straight, but if you hit him in the liver a couple times, nice squishy part, see you later. You'll go down much faster that way with bare knuckles.
Yeah, and the old fucking kidney jab. I mean, there's so
the old kidney. Oh yeah,
so many places you can just up under the armpit. That's a place I've been punched. That's always
that makes you shit your pants. We all know that.
It does. Yeah, I've never shit my pants that, but I've been punched.
You know, the armpit. They shit their pants. That's
good
true.
Good spot to get fucking hit.
So yeah, the guy became a local legend. And yeah, the more he fought, the more people were upset, because he was not only, like I said, this black guy from America who was beating all these English boxers with the bottom and all their British mentality and stiff upper lip. These guys were running the world at the time, and this was a big part of their ego, like how they love soccer now. They liked boxing then, and it was not cool that an American former slave was going over here and jumping around, bobbing, weaving, and beating the hell out of all their guys. So they nicknamed him the Black Terror, and they put him up against the up-and-comer named Thomas Cribb. Thomas Cribb was a guy he was in his early 20s. At this point, Richmond was in his 40s and was fighting 20-year-old kids who were beasts. This guy, Cribb, was working his way up the circuit, and he was one of the best boxers in the country. And they were like, listen, they're the Black Terror from America. You're going to have to fight a good English boy, Thomas Cribb. He's a young bloke. He's a big man. He's got the bottom. He knows how to stand there and take punches. And also, the people who see boxing and the boxing fans were called fancy.
Are you kidding me? That's right.
Yeah, they're called the fancy. Like how you call the Beyonce's listeners the Beehive. They were called the fancy. Weird.
That is weird. Also, Thomas Cribb, that guy looks fucking ridiculous. Did you ever see his fucking picture?
Yeah, he's if you look to the side of my ear there he is right there. Thomas Cribb with his sideburns.
Oh, yeah. So that's a really nice...
Spoiler alert on the story, but yeah, that is him.
Yeah, that's a nice picture of him, but he has a... he has another painted photo of him that's really funny. Like, it really
we'll put him up for the podcast for sure. I'm gonna put up all their fighting pictures because they all look so goofy. It's like the toughest guys in the world are they have like a mustache and like curly hair and stuff, and they're like, oh, put up your dukes there, buddy.
Yeah, also his early Wick's early life is the most English thing I've ever heard in my fucking life. Born in Wick near the Hannam area of Bristol. Cribb moved to London at the age of 13, and after working as a bell hanger, he sought work as a coal porter in Wapping.
Oh, Tommy Cribb there, the Cribb boy from downtown Bristol.
Move over here to Wapping, come here and go fight some people off from the... Yeah, it's good shit.
Pop your jokes there, you bloke. But yeah, and he was the exact example of a guy who was a poor white dude from England trying to fight for the country while this... this black guy who they viewed as like, oh, you're less than us. He had money. He had his own business. And he was like, I'll kick this kid's ass. He's half my age. I'll beat him down good.
Hell yeah, he will.
Unfortunately for our guy, Bill Richmond, Cribb was a phenomenon. And he really had that bottom down. And he was his bottom bitch. He was England's bottom bitch for sure. Mm-hmm. And he lost badly. The guy was a tank. So even though he had his bob and weave method, he was getting on in age and he just couldn't get the right amount of strikes in to take Cribb down. So he lost. And when he lost, he took it very badly because he was not used to losing and he didn't like this young up-and-comer getting in part of his mojo. And he kind of like moved on from there. After he lost to Cribb, he's like, well, I can only fight Cribb again. Once you make it to that upper echelon, you got to fight the champ. And Cribb is now the champ. So he decided to take some of his massive amount of money that he's earned, and he parlayed it into buying his own business. He stopped selling cabinets, bought a pub, and started a boxing training center, one of the earliest ones that we know about. And that's where in comes to our story, our main character, Tom Molineaux, his student.
His first student. So we're wrapping up Tom Cribb. Not wrapping up, but he's going to be a part of this. But I just really need to just say that I just can't believe how many different pictures of this guy there are.
Of Tom Cribb. Yeah, he was a national hero.
Yeah, he was a national hero, but there's like, he looks so different in every picture. And every single
one. Yeah, I wonder what he really looked like, because he's like right on the cusp of when they had photography, but they also had paintings. It was like kind of weird middle ground.
Yeah, I'm sure he's a great guy, but every single one of them is somebody that definitely has one of the most punchable faces I've ever seen in my life.
I mean, think that was part of his gift and his curse, is that he had the most punchable face and it could take the most punches. Like, yeah, God blessed him with a face that could take a punch, but he also cursed him with the most punchable face.
That's almost like being a cuck. Just sitting.
Bill Richmond knows all about that. I mean, this guy's own.
I think he does.
He's from Cucktown, USA.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. It's almost like the same thing. Oh, you just stand there and just get punched the whole time. It's pretty much just like watching your wife just get railed by.
yeah, she's getting tongue punched.
She's getting fucking railed by some other dude. It's almost the same thing.
Yeah, it's basically a one-on-one comparison. Yeah, you wouldn't want to be in that position.
It's a lot more fun and less painful to just punch someone on the other end of that. Like they're that punching bag that is the guy, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Like the body without any arms that you like do like the punching bag on. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's a two-way street for sure. I mean, it's like, all right, cool, I'm gonna stand here and just get punched and show you how tough I can handle physical pain. Mm-hmm. Or you can be like, hey, or you can be our buddy Tom here and be like, they're gonna do that and throw a couple punches every now and then, but if I just never stop punching them, this will eventually work in my favor. We're both fighting the duration game, and if I can just keep fucking hitting you in the nose,
yeah, I mean, that really is
going to start hitting your spinal cord. So
your brainstem somewhere back there. Let's just keep punching through it.
Yeah. So I'm just going to keep doing that. And if my hand all of a sudden turns into just a fucking rod, and I'm just, it's still
gonna, all the better for stabbing you with my fucking humerus.
Yeah.
It's so true.
Yeah. So what a weird game of those times.
Just madness.
Yeah. Yep, sure is. So we talked about
want to get into Tommy Boy now?
Tommy Crib. Let's get back into Tommy.
No, Tom Molineaux, our main character. Okay. Yep. They're both named Tom. It's confusing.
So
I'm gonna call him Crib and Molineaux, probably just to assume.
Let's do that. Yeah, Molineaux and Crib. So back into Molineaux. So we just cleared up early 1800s, right?
Late 1700s, and we're gonna get into the, well, that was probably bled into like 1804 or something.
So here's the thing. So 1809, Molineaux found his way to London, where he made contact with Billy, aka Bill Richmond, another slave turned boxer who ran the pub.
That's our guy. That's the guy we just talked about the whole time. Bill Richmond.
Right. So that was, I'm just saying that was in 1809.
Yeah. So I think that it's probably around a little bit earlier than that is when he lost to Tom Crib.
Yep. Cause it says on 3 December, 1810, trained by Bill Richmond.
Yeah.
Fought Tom Crib at the Sheddington Hollow in Oxfordshire for.
Yeah. That's the big fight. Coming
up. Yeah.
That's the big fight. That's going to be like my second to last thing is that big, cause that's, he didn't have much after that, unfortunately, for the lifestyle he was leading.
Yep. Okay. Gotcha. All righty. Yep. So you pick it up on your timeline, and I know we'll just fit right into that.
I don't want to spill all my beans already.
You can do it. Let's spill. Let's get in the beans.
So you want to bring us
boxing? Let's get in the beans.
Yeah. Right. So.
Or you know what? Honestly, let's get right in the fucking bottom.
Yeah, let's get right in the bottom. Let's not pussyfoot around here.
Yeah, it's a boxing term.
I'm one of the fancy. So yeah, so that gets us into our main character of our story here, which is he's named Tom Molineaux. Now, of course, his name wasn't Tom Molineaux. He was named that because his last name was the name of his slave owner. His name was whatever his parents wanted to name him, but they called him Tom Molineaux. And much like Bill Richmond, he made it out of slavery and became a boxer. He grew up in Virginia, not from Cucktown.
It's very important to know that.
He was from a different town. And but much like Bill, he also was a part of the fighting circuit, where he would be pitted against other slaves, and much like Bill, he would beat all of them. But unlike Bill, he wasn't a guy who would stick and move into a quick little guy. He was a monster, and he would just beat the hell out of people. He was the British bottom, that kind of thing, where he just wail on people. He actually had a signature punch that was called the hammer, which he would just take his fist. It's exactly what you think it is. He'd take his fist like this, you know, perpendicular to the ground, and you just slam it on the guy's head like he was bopping him on the head of the hammer. Now, if any boxer did that nowadays, it'd be the most insane punch of all time, and it seems super uncoordinated, not technically sound. You're hitting the top of a person's head with the soft part of your hand. Here's the thing, it worked. That's how strong he was. He would bop people on the head and KO them with a big bopper.
Hey, like I said, it makes sense actually, because like
it works. Knuckle,
so it doesn't hurt you as bad because you've got muscle there. So
you're right. It doesn't break your fingers. It just bops. Yeah, but it just seems so uncoordinated. But yeah, you bop on that with a hammer.
It's called Gary Flintstones type of move.
Yeah, they get the big lump on their head that grows, and they have the birds fly around it.
Bopping people on the head. It's really funny. But do you have his? So I can't find how much he weighed. Do you have any? Because like
198 pounds, I have.
So he's 5'8", 200 pounds. Me and Joe are somewhere between 5'8" and 5'9". No one knows.
Yep.
That's a big dude who's all fucking muscle.
All muscle. All,
literally his only diet the whole time is mashed peas and gravy.
Yeah, and just work. That's what the human body can achieve when forced to.
Yeah, when forced to on mashed peas and gravy, you can bop a bunch of bottoms on the top of their head.
On the top. Bop those bottoms on the top. Bop those
bottoms on the fucking top, and it is KO City.
It is. He was raised in KO City, Virginia, which he was born and raised.
Yep. And
But 200 pounds is big. It's, I mean, 5'8 was it's the international average height for a man nowadays, which means that most people aren't 5'8". It averages out. But at the time that he was born and raised, 5'8 was closer to the tallest people were. Again, to bring up the feet size, hand, whatever. In that time period, without all our modern McDonald's and vitamins and everything else we got, people would not usually reach 200 pounds at 5'8". That was a pretty rare occasion. And Tom, even though obviously he worked his ass off to get that strong, he was definitely genetically gifted. I mean, this guy was gifted with being a solid brick house of a man. And that's why he was so good at fighting. Unlike Richmond, who was like trained himself to be a defensive fighter, Tom Molineaux was just, he was a natural fighter. You just fuck people up. You don't fuck with him.
Yeah. It's awesome. Yeah, I think that they call them shit brick houses now.
Brick shit houses. Yeah.
No, sorry. Yeah, we're not talking about the chicken house. Don't get confused.
He's a brick shit house. He's building a brick shit house, and that's for sure.
Brick shit house for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. He worked his way out of slavery eventually for working for the liaison to England from America. But this is, you got to imagine right now, this is right after the Revolutionary War, because we're hitting 1800 and before the War of 1812. So Britain is tentatively hanging on to the United States. They're not huge about it, but Britain's about to abolish slavery altogether, and the United States is going to fight a war about it in 50 years, so they're pretty far away. So he becomes basically the champion of the United States by moving to New York and just pummeling people to shreds. He ends up moving to England with his the ambassador to England from America, and ends up making his own way there. Now, his plan right away, because he doesn't have a trade, he doesn't have money, he's just a free man, is to meet up with this guy he's heard about, who's a former slave from America, who moved to England and made a life for himself by beating the hell out of these British boys who think they're too hot for school, those bottoms out there. So he goes and meets up with our former star of the show here, Bill Richmond, who started a boxing school. And he says, set me up, Bill. What do I need to do?
Set me up, Bill. I want to beat the shit out of a bunch of blokes over here in England who think they're better than us. I'm going to pound them on top of their head like it was their fucking cuck house.
I'm going to hammer them down. I'm going to hammer them down.
Hammer them down with my fist.
And Bill is like, I thought you'd never ask. I was just looking for a guy like you.
Yep. And if you're wondering how hard he can hit someone on top of their head, anyone ever see the movie Rollerball?
Actually, yes. That's that's got some crazy scenes in that movie. The futuristic crazy
scenes, but it's also got somebody related to our buddy here, Tom Molineaux.
Oh man, yeah. I definitely forgot that that guy was in it.
I had to mention this, and
right it has to be brought up.
It's got to be brought up. It's got to be brought up.
Bring it up right now.
A brick shithouse singer who is probably 5'8". I got to look it up. I don't know. LL Cool J, descendant of Tom Molineaux. Just like a girl who went to middle school who's a descendant of Abraham Lincoln. It's like the same thing.
Yep, that's right. And he's not joking around, folks. He is actually a descendant of Tom Molineaux. And not only that, what's LL Cool J's most famous song he ever did? Mama said, knock you out. I'm going to knock you out. I mean, he couldn't even have known that, but it's just in his blood. Did
he
even know
then? Because he probably took 23andMe and then realized he's fucking...
I don't think he took 23andMe in 1995 or whenever that song came out, but it was something about him.
He just might have said that, and then it was like, he didn't even know until later that he's like...
He knew later.
I'm 4, 5, 6 generations ago.
Back from Tom Molineaux.
My old man. And yeah. He used to knock people out. I always thought.
Mama said knock you out.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the shit. He's related to LL Cool J.
Wow. That's cool. Also known as James Todd Smith.
No wonder he changed his name. It's the whitest name I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah.
James Todd Smith. If you said that was in a novel for a white guy.
It just gets better the more you dig into LL Cool J. Yep, you're right, Joe. James Todd Smith. Also known as LL Cool J, which is short for Ladies Love Cool James.
Wait, that's the LL. It's Ladies Love.
Ladies Love.
Which is the same for the clothing company, Ladies Love Bean.
Well, then cool, and then J is James. Ladies Love Cool James.
Ladies Love Cool James. James Todd. That actually ties together with the Abraham Lincoln, because Mary Todd Lincoln and James Todd Cool J. All right. So that being said, it had
some flavor in our ears, Joe.
I put some flavor in. He goes up, and after meeting up with Mr. Richmond, he sets him up with a fight. This is before he starts training him extensively. He's just housing him. He says, "You want to fight? I know how to fight." And he sets up a fight with Jack Burroughs, another British bloke, to go in and fight amongst both of them. And he won both of his first two fights that Richmond set up for him. The first one lasted 65 minutes. It's the only one I've seen listed without rounds. So it makes me think that they weren't even counting the rounds. He was just fighting them away.
Well, it's a long time to just get punched in the fucking nose. I'm just saying.
It's insanely long. I mean, I should have looked up. We'll put it up here how long modern boxing rounds last, but we already told you about the rules before. It's just insane to go an hour and 5 minutes toe-to-toe, just bare-knuckling this guy. And they would fight in like open fields and shit. It wasn't in an arena, you know. They would just circle around and go, here's the area, fight away.
The average boxing length is about 5.9 rounds, totaling 15 to 47 minutes.
Right, so 47 would be the long version. And this is his first fight in England. It's an hour and 5 minutes, and he does win.
Dude, can you imagine that? That's like so exhausting. So like I wrestled for 3 years, and the only way I can describe that type of activity, because we all played basketball and soccer and fucking right.
But you're not struggling against other people, you're struggling against yourself.
No, and if you, so it's the same type of mental attitude you need to say, hey Joe, this is what you're gonna do to train. You're gonna see that telephone pole right there. You see that fucking thing? Go hug it as hard as you can for 3 minutes. Don't let up. That's exhausting. The same type of mental strength you need to do boxing, or for me it was wrestling.
Yeah.
But you just hold on to something as hard as you can as wrestling, but boxing is the same thing. Just go punch that telephone pole for 45 seconds. You go, come on, like that's fucking crazy. Like that's what it is.
Yeah. And I mean, the amount of people can watch and you see people running or see people throwing stuff. Yeah, and it takes a lot out of you. But try throwing punches for 30 seconds. You're gonna sound like you just ran a marathon. Like you're just gasping for breath. You're using your whole body the entire time. So multiply that times 100, and you're close to where that fight was ending, an hour and 5 minutes. I mean, I can't imagine the exhaustion, the physical pain. I mean, just like you said, the mental toughness. You have to have like a certain mindset to even be able to start fighting, never mind continue it on.
And no one's saying this yet, and I didn't read any of my stories, but none of them were wearing suspenders. So
no. They were shirtless. That was one of the uniform things. You got to go shirtless.
But that's a huge stress. So let's just paint the picture here real quick.
Please.
Sweaty, no deodorant, no fucking shit like that.
Haven't taken, what's a shower? We don't know what that is. Haven't taken a bath in probably a month and a half.
Maybe more. We've seen Pirates of the Caribbean. A bath is like a luxury. It's like eating caviar.
Yeah,
like,
rich people do it.
How about you come over for a glass of champagne and a bath? And they go, that was the Southern accent, but...
point is made though. Well, dude, done.
Sometimes it just gets all confusing. Far as accents go, it's like same idea. Like, oh, come have a bath in a glass.
I'll draw a bath for you in the loo in the water closet.
Yeah, come over here, and so you got that sweaty fucking ball sweat, dude. And you're wearing these 100% cotton pants. And
they don't breathe
because I have a pair of wool pants that are very old, and they need suspenders or a belt.
Yeah, just can't keep them up.
Rubber ain't a fucking thing yet. I don't think they figured out how to make latex into stretchy shit. So those pants ain't fitting good, dude. I promise. I know.
No, they're not.
I know
they're not fitting good.
If you wear a non-stretchy type of waistband, that guy's worried about his pants coming down. That's why it was so funny in like Muppets Treasure Island.
Yeah,
pants fall off because it was like when people's pants used to just
fall
off back then. Like that was genuinely a concern. Like, oh, I hope I don't like have to run away from that.
And my pants hit the ground. Because my
pants might fall off. Like, unless you're wearing the old fucking suspenders,
you gotta
worry. It's a constant fear. Constant fear that someone's gonna see your fucking wingy wang.
Yeah, and then you have a tripwire around your ankles. And I think that they probably would like to wear suspenders just for that case. But you know your opponent can use them against you. So if you're wearing suspenders, they could just grab them and just slap them right up against your nips. And then that's a little stunner move. So I recommend not even wearing them.
My favorite fighting moves of all time are the embarrassing ones, like you just said. Like, hey, the guy's in front of you running away, and you grab his suspenders and
let him rip. Yeah, from like a bowstring, just let him behind your ear.
His back. It's the same thing. Like, there's one scene in Dumb and Dumber where Harry and Lloyd and they walk into this fucking thing, and they're wearing, one's wearing purple, one's wearing orange, and they're walking to
the fence. I do remember the orange suspenders.
They have canes. And Harry pisses off Lloyd, so or vice versa, so he hits him as hard as he can with the cane in the ass, and it was very it's just so funny. Like, there's so many little things you can do that hurt really bad that
they look funny when you do it too.
Yeah, and back then you could pant somebody
like easily.
No problem. This would be a good fighting move. And again, like I said,
pants.
They're embarrassed. Their butt is showing. Because did they wear underwear back then?
Yeah, well, they wore pants. What they would call pants would be like it's like pants that are beneath your pants that like go down to your knees too. Where we would call them boxers, which is kind of ironic, or like underwear. But they would call those pants, and they would call what they wear trousers. So they pull their trousers down, and then all you're wearing is pants. Ah. But pants aren't pants though; it's your undies. It's like saying, like, I pulled your pants down, all you're wearing is tidy whities. They'd say, I pulled your trousers down, and all you're wearing is pants.
I can imagine the skid marks and those fucking things. I mean,
oh, like, good lord,
bad, dude! You only have like two sets, and you have no washing machine or
no bleach. Anything. Bleach is not
no nothing. Just those are a fucking mess, and you know they didn't wear a new pair every day. No way.
Definitely not. And it was not like they washed and then they put the same pair on. Nothing was getting washed.
Well, and the
not friends, their bodies or the pants.
Our friends here have 15 times the amount of ball sweat those guys do, and they're covered in blood.
Mm-hmm.
Blood and
oh yeah, the blood. I mean, I can't even imagine the people, the cut man in boxing today, where they kind of just, you know, made the swelling go down. There was no idea about medicine. I'm surprised they didn't bring leeches into these matches. These guys were getting beat to a bloody pulp that you could barely see after, I'm sure, 4 or 5 rounds, never mind going an hour and 5 minutes. I mean, God dang.
You gotta get a book. I mean, maybe they were at least I mean, peeing on each other after a wound? I don't know. Like,
I don't think so.
Is it the same thing as getting stung by a jellyfish? Like getting a back then?
No, you, yeah, no, I don't think that that was quite the case. I don't think they knew. I mean, this is the early 1800s. I mean, we're about 50 years away from the Civil War where they were still cutting people's legs off. So I don't think they really knew about sanitation and antiseptic at the time, really. Or at least not enough in a boxing match. They couldn't handle it in a war.
Yeah, I mean, just so you know, they're still cutting people's legs off. That wasn't just an 1800s thing. But it's not in boxing matches.
I mean, when you get a cut and you get infected, they don't remove your arm anymore. But in 1800, it's either that or you're dead. So
yeah, I've seen Master and Commander. I know what you're talking about.
Oh, you know what I'm fucking talking about.
You see that movie?
Oh yeah, Russell Crowe. Fucking, I can't remember the name of the ship, but yeah, it's exactly it's around that same time period. We're talking about the same time.
The Black Peril. Anyways, moving on. So,
the Black Peril, the Master and Commander.
Sorry, Flying Dutchman.
Neither of those are
probably the.
It's called like the Queen Marie or something like that. No, the Queen Mary's Blackbeard ship.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, so. Anyways, let's move on to boxing. Enough maritime. Yeah.
No, I'm glad you brought it up though, because it puts us in the mentality of like what it is like to be there. Because the whole crowd is smelling it too, and they're watching the whole thing. They're cheering on.
It fucking smells, man. It really does.
Everyone smells. I think it's like The Incredibles. Everyone's super, then nobody's super. And I think everyone smelled terrible, so no one knew the difference. You just everyone smelled, so you get used to it, or you don't. You know,
yeah,
you
smell. Could be a turn on for some of these people too.
Oh, it was.
And as you mentioned earlier, if just one of them decided to punch the other one in the armpit, they'd shit. So
they would shit, and the fight would be over.
Too. It's a fact. Go punch. Yeah, if you're listening to the podcast, punch who's ever next to you in the car in the armpit. See what happens.
In the armpit, like get them to put their hands up, and then just punch them as hard as you can in the armpit. They will shit.
Tell me, say, hey, I've got a game. Everyone's gonna put their arms up in the air real quick, and whoever does the longest wins. Immediately punch in the armpit.
Yep, and then they will shit, and it will be hilarious.
Yeah, it's the only way to figure this out. That was a thing that was happening back then all the time.
Oh yeah, yeah. That's why they would stand like this and have their armpits closed and have their fists close to their body. Because if they put their arms up to guard their face, boom, right in the armpit, you shit your pants, fight's over.
Yeah, and then you get scared, and then you go, "Oh, I made a mistake," and then they beat the shit out of you because you shit because they made you shit.
Yeah, they beat the shit out of your trousers, and then you all you have is pants.
Yeah, you could barely stand in line at a coffee shop back then and have someone not do that to you.
If you were in a coffee shop in the year 1805 and they said, whose meal is this? And you put your hand up, you would get punched in the armpit and you would shit in public.
Yeah, it happened so much. It just wasn't documented as much because the church documented most things.
Well, it's embarrassing. People wouldn't admit it.
Much.
Right, exactly. Yeah, so it was. You don't hear about it a lot. But I mean, if you need any more proof that it happened, go ahead, have your friend raise their hand. Ask them a question that's really easy and go class dismissed and then punch them in the armpit as hard as you can. And then you tell me what you smell. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Hear, smell, see, whatever.
Yeah. Hear me now, smell it later. You know what I mean? Don't take my word for it. Read a rainbow.
Don't be embarrassed. Happens to you. It's happened to the best of us.
And don't do it to yourself. It's like tickling yourself. You can't. That's not how it works. You have to do it to someone else.
Yeah,
I know you're getting all cute with us here. Oh, I'll do it to myself. You won't hit hard enough. Yeah. You won't. Do it to right someone now. Else and do it as hard as you can. They will shit their pants.
Yep.
And then who's laughing all the way to the fucking changing station? You are. That's who.
Yeah. Yeah. That's it. Yeah. So the
second fight he had after that one only went 8 rounds. He beat the ever-loving hell out of this guy, Tom Blake. And that fight was August 21st, 1810.
Blake is not a good name.
Yep. At Apple Bay near Margate. All the names of the places are so much like cuter in English that now fights would be like at the Costco Arena. And that back then it was the great fight at Apple Bay at Margate. Who could forget? Yeah. Down by the Fens.
That's a better time now. Yeah, like you said, the Costco Arena or the...
Bank
North Garden that always gives me overdraft fees, and I'm actually going to go punch them in the fucking armpit any of these days.
Don't forget about the crypto.com arena that's recently been named in Los Angeles. Crypto.com arena. That one definitely will age like milk, I'm sure.
Yeah, and I hope it fucking crashes because fuck crypto. I'm so sick of it. Anyways,
I wonder if you can spend crypto on like beers and pretzels there, because if you can't spend crypto there, then where can you spend it, you know?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, that's fucked.
And that was that. So only with 8 rounds, so we'd say that's probably much less than the 65 minutes of the last round. He beats the shit out of this Jack guy.
Jack Burrows, then we got Tom Blake. And this is just for the record, folks. This is 18-10.
It's 18-10. It's August 21st. So after
30 days in between fights, which is way less than the
That's insane. Yeah, the amount of damage. I mean, he probably still has swelling and he probably still can't move his jaw the right way, but he's going to fight again. And he beats him in less than half the time. Just beats the hell out of this guy. So at that point, he becomes the hot guy in town. He's already declared himself the champion of America. That's like being the best baseball player in Japan. You got to win in America now. But at that time, Britain was the America of the bare-knuckle boxing world. So yeah, you're the champion of America. You got to win in Britain. You got to win in England. And we got a guy, I don't know if you ever heard of him before, but his name's Tom Cribb.
His name's
Tom Cribb.
Thomas.
And he had already won the fight against Tom Molineaux, his sensei, his teacher, Bill Richmond. And before this fight, he calls out Tom Cribb and he goes, I'm the champion of America. I'm going to be the champion of England. You can't beat me. You're not going to beat me. And that's where we should get into the lifestyle of Tom Molineaux, because unlike Bill Richmond, his teacher, who was a guy, he married a white woman in England. He owned his own business. He owned his own pub, his own boxing. He was all set up and society hated him, but he couldn't give a shit. Tom Molineaux was a fighter through and through. He was super into spending all his money on eating delicious food, drinking booze, and meeting up with the ladies, and the ladies loved them.
Fucking insane, dude. He's got it.
He spent most of his money on prostitutes and alcohol, and he just would fight his way through.
Yep.
So this guy was living la vida loca, living fast and living hard, fast
living
and
on, living on top.
Living on Tom Molineaux for sure. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I had to bring that up because it comes up later. But yeah, so he's doing that. And so Richmond sets up the fight with him and Tom Cribb, who is the guy. It's like Rocky. It's like Drago beat Apollo Creed and Rocky's going to have to go in and do some vengeance for him. So Richmond goes, hey, man, you got to beat Cribb. But here's the thing. You can't just beat him with your hammer fists and your standing around mentality. You're going to have to actually like learn the technical parts of fighting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Richmond's like, but the good thing is I'm the guy who's good at that. I made a whole career of boxing on sticking and moving and using technique and outlasting them and winning. And Molineaux's like, yeah, old man, whatever you say. And he does go to train with them, but he doesn't take it very seriously. Half the time he's showing up late. He's ending up in bed with all kinds of pretty ladies, I'm sure, and having too much of the common drink of the common man there, the swill and all that. But Richmond does his best over that winter, from August to December of that year, to train him up, because Richmond knows what Cribb is like, because he fought him before and he lost. And Cribb doesn't even really want to fight this guy, because Cribb has retired in that time between when Bill and Tom were supposed to fight. Not because he was old, because no one wanted to fight him anymore. He became the boxing champion and no one would take him on. So he had retired and he'd been living large on the town and being a national hero. But he couldn't resist the urge once Tom called him out and called him the new champion to fight him. So they go fight.
They go fight. And I was going to say that Thomas Cribb, before we can carry on, he was trained by a guy that went by Captain Robert Barclay Allardyce.
Yeah, which was even a better boxing trainer than Bill Richmond. You know, the guy was a legend.
And it's because his most famous feat, I mean, this guy lived for 70 something years or whatever it is.
And that's a long time back then.
It sure is. It really is. And he had his fucking army thing, whatever the fuck, no one cares. And he was most known, not for his penis size, believe it or not, for his, he walked 1,000 miles in 1,000 hours for 1,000 guineas. And a guinea is a coin minted in Great Britain between 1663 and 1814.
Yeah, it's like before the British pound. That's what they called it.
Yeah, so $1,000, he walked 1,000 miles in 1,000 hours.
And I love the old timey words. They call them a legendary pedestrian, which I never put that together in my head. It means someone who walks.
Dude,
so
he's
like
the
all-time pedestrian. Yeah.
Dude, he walked 1,000 miles. Father of the 19th century sport of pedestrianism.
Which just means walking.
Yeah, I'm a sport pedestrian. I'm a human who walks.
When you're tired, I just keep walking twice as far. That's what I do.
Yep, I walk. I do crosswalks, cross streets. I go to malls and walk there. I walk anywhere you want. I can walk anywhere.
He can fast. Keep walking.
I can do a mile an hour, which is actually pretty bad.
It's bad, but if you go for 1,000 miles, that's pretty good.
No, but I feel like my average pace, if I were to walk, would be at least a mile, a 30-minute mile walking.
So like 2 miles an hour.
So he's probably just shitting his fucking underpants or whatever you call them, pants?
Yeah.
He shits his pants, but not his trousers, and just walks really slow. I mean, this isn't even a feat besides 1,000 miles.
Well, that's what I mean. 1,000 in 1,000 hours. That means that, I mean, I could probably walk 3 miles an hour for a couple hours, but I couldn't do that for 1,000 hours. At some point, I'd be walking like half a mile an hour, which would kill your time. I think that on average, walking 1,000 miles in 1,000 hours is pretty good. If I was going to walk 60 miles, I wouldn't be walking 2 miles an hour the whole time. At some point, I'd be walking like very slowly.
Back home, they didn't even have Cliff Bars or like those goo packets. So he was just given, someone just had to have.
He probably just had a water canteen and just, do you think someone was walking with him? I think he was walking by himself.
Hey, sorry to break your heart, Toots, but he probably just had brandy in a fucking cup.
Yeah, he probably didn't have water, just a cup of brandy.
So water didn't exist back then. I don't know if you know this.
I always forget it was that.
Just brandy or beer.
Yeah.
He wasn't drinking water. He was drinking brandy, and then all of a sudden someone just said, "Hey, mate, I see you walking. Pedestrianism. Here's a piece of toast with some beans on it."
He was like, "Blimey, best meal I ever saw."
Blimey, jerk me off 6 ways from Saturday. Ain't no bar.
Oh, but he was Scottish though, so he was like, "I can't believe it, laddie. Just what I needed in this cold, foggy morning."
Exactly.
A slice of toast and some beans. You know I'm a legendary pedestrian, don't you, lad?
Dude, was that him? I feel like that was just a cut in of him speaking.
Yeah, I acted like I said it, but I actually cut in a real audio recording.
Yeah, it's a real actual audio recording of our friend here. So that's who trained
Jim Daddy.
Tom Cribb's trainer, just like Yoda in the famous movie Star Wars.
Attack of the Clones.
Famous pedestrian trains Tom Cribb.
Yep, he's his trainer. And that's where we get into our pinnacle, our Super Bowl of bare knuckle boxing. It's the legendary pedestrian and Bill Richmond and their two pupils, which are Tom Cribb, the undisputed champion of England, therefore the world at the time, and America's champion, Tom Molineaux, underneath the tutelage of old Richie there, fighting for his sensei's honor, as you would say, because Tom Cribb has not been defeated by them, and Tom's going to beat him. It was one of the biggest events of the entire year. Hundreds of people showed up, and it was a 5-mile walk in a muddy field, it was described, and it was pouring rain. So in other words, any day in England.
Yeah, yes.
Any sporting event, a 5-mile walk in a muddy field, raining down the rain. So torrential downpours, it almost seems like a movie. I intended to believe that the accounts of the story are true, but it's almost too good to be true that it'd be pouring rain during this, you know, penultimate matchup between America's former slave, freed and fighting for the honor of himself and his sensei, Bill Richmond, and the livelihood of England, who were running the world at the time. We have a well-bred boy from, where is he from? Bristol. And he's an Englishman, and we run the world, we run this country, and this little white boy is going to win it for us. So there's a lot at stake, not just in the matchup, but for the country at large. It was meaning a lot to people, more than it should have, maybe.
I mean, what else was England and specifically London doing back then, or Bristol, whatever the fuck? I mean,
I think subjugating other countries, mostly.
Yeah, there was entertainment wise, it was just alcohol. So it's like, all right, let's see what this fucking entertainment is here. And
it was like, either I'm going to get punched in the face or I can watch other people do it. But there's not much more to do.
Yeah. Yeah, there's really just none.
Exactly right. So the fight begins, and it's Molineaux v. Crib. For the bets, they actually still have the odds on the betting, because obviously it's a fight, you have to bet on it. And Crib had 4-1 odds, meaning if you bet $1 for Molineaux and he won, you get $4 out of that.
It's a good deal.
I mean, he's not supposed to win. People are even taking individual bets on how many rounds that Tom Molineaux would make it before he'd get his ass kicked. They thought it would be less than 10. You can make even more money to be like, if he makes less than 10 rounds and he gets KO'd, you get more money. And everyone was betting on it. And most of the crowd there, it's a hometown game. He's in England. He's got a couple people on his side, basically just Richmond. And the fight begins, and it's described as maybe the best fight of the century, and certainly in contention for the best boxing matches of all time. These guys go at it. These titans slugging it away, going tit for tat, using the bottom method, standing still. Yeah, Molineaux is trying to use the train.
Made fun of it, but the bottom method is like, no one's fucking around with that.
Yeah, but Richmond is trying to beg Tom, you got to do the stick and move method. Don't just stand there. And Tom's dropping hammers. He's doing the hammer punch. You know, you can picture that. They said within the first 10 rounds, not only did Molineaux not go down, but the two fighters' faces were so beaten to a pulp and bruised and swollen that it was indistinguishable if you looked at their faces. All the blood and pus and the swelling, you couldn't tell. You can only tell by the color of their skin and what side they went to as the round ended, because they were so just beaten to hell.
In the first 10 rounds. Event where you don't just slay after you win a game. It's just not even possible.
You can't even barely even see anything or talk.
All right, I hope not. I mean, that's pretty gross.
Well, you're supposed to save it up until after your fight, right? Even nowadays in modern boxing, keep that's that testosterone
true. yeah no, exactly. We were taught that in soccer in seventh grade. Don't everybody jerk off before our game tomorrow, because you'll get balls hard. You know, that is
terrible coaching.
That was what we were told from the coach when we were in seventh grade playing soccer. It's just, I'm just stating facts here.
I know, but it's terrible coaching. It's terrible coaching. It shouldn't matter with soccer. It doesn't even matter with boxing, really, but it's a superstition thing, I think, more than anything.
Yeah.
But I can see having more testosterone makes you better at fighting. Well, sure, more aggressive, whatever. I get it. But even at that point in the fight, these guys were still going. It wasn't going to go 8 rounds. It wasn't going to go 10 rounds. It was going to go much more than that. And we were about 10 to 20 rounds in when the most exciting parts of the fight started happening. Now people are starting to realize Crib isn't going to beat him handily. Crib might actually have to fight this thing out. I mean, this guy is fighting him hard. And they want him to win immediately. It's not like they want an exciting match to last a long time. Of course, they want it to be thrilling. But what they want is England's bright star boy to beat the hell out of this guy, and that's over. We win again, and he's the champion forever. But Molineaux gets him beat back into a corner, the corner of the ring, and he's beating him punch, 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 punch. And people are seeing it. Oh, shit. Crib could lose right here. And it's only like, I don't know what it was. They didn't have the exact count, but maybe let's say 13, 14 rounds in. And the crowd gets pissed off. And they do the first part of this match, which in the modern day would disqualify anybody. The crowd starts charging into the ring and stopping Tom Molineaux from punching him. The entire mob grabs Molineaux away from Crib as Crib is in a stupor. He's in a coma there in the corner. They pull him away. They drag him off. They start beating him. And they even break one of his fingers as he's pulled away from him. The entire mob comes in. What's the ref do? The ref checks and sees if Tom Crib is okay, and then looks up at the crowd. He's not going to fight the crowd. He just goes, oh, yeah, keep the match going. Finally, they subside with enough time for Crib to get up, regain his energy, and get back into the fight. First insane disqualification thing. The crowd stopped him. He was going to win the fight right then. It was over. They knew it was over. They freaked out and took him out. And the fight raged on. The rain's pouring down, blood pouring down their faces. They can barely stand up. 20 rounds. We're into 30 rounds at this point. We're 30 rounds in, and Molineaux delivers a punch. He starts doing the more of the Richmond method, bobbing and weaving, conserving energy, gets a punch straight to Crib's face. Crib goes down like a sack of shit. Boom, he's down. Now, we mentioned earlier, you have to make it back to the scratch in 30 seconds or the fight's over. He's got no chance. He's on the ground. He's fucking done. Molineaux.
You can't curb stomp because it's boxing.
You can't curb stomp. Yeah, yeah. I forgot. I couldn't mention. One of the rules is no curb stomp.
Yeah, I didn't. I didn't know if anyone knew this. I had to bring it up.
That's a good point because you might be thinking that's when you curb stomp him. Why wouldn't you?
Just curb stomp him.
So, finish him. Finish him. As they would say. Yeah.
Easy, but you're not allowed to curb stomp in boxing.
Not allowed. Not part of the rules. But the rules are you got to make it back there in 30 seconds, and he's not going to make it back. And the crowd knows that. So once again, the crowd turns against Tom Molineaux, and one of the crowd members accuses him and says, referee, he has bullets in his hands. You're like, what? He's holding bullets in his hands, so his fists weigh more. So when he's punching, he's hitting him harder. He's cheating. The referee goes, all right, let's settle down now. The crowd's obviously going apeshit. This guy's accused of cheating, and he opens up his hands. What do you think's there? Nothing. Of course not. He's not holding bullets in his hands. There's nothing going on there. But what that's doing is it's buying time for Tom Crib to get up. And the more time the referee's bullshitting with this crazy conspiracy idea that the guy's cheating, the more time for Tom Crib to get up. Tom Crib gets up a second time after he's lost twice now, and he's still fighting because people can't stand the idea that Molineaux could beat this guy. And the fight goes to the 30-second round. Both of the guys don't throw a punch in the 30-second round. They both collapsed, but they didn't call the fight. They dragged him back up for the 33rd round. It makes it all the way to, we have it listed here, 35 rounds of this boxing match. And it gets to the point where Molineaux's eyes are so swollen shut, he can no longer see. And Richmond calls the fight. Fight goes to Thomas Crib, who wins yet again and retains his championship belt as the number one heavyweight champion of England. Molineaux loses the fight.
Classic cuck.
Huge time cuck.
Oh, as what I always say. And it doesn't say anything about him and the ladies or the dudes. So you can assume that he's not hanging a hard one.
Yeah, not he's not pulling him in the way that Richmond and Molineaux are, where they were those consummate ladies' men.
Fucking slaying because they were packing a fucking punch downstairs.
Yeah, and they were packing a punch upstairs, downstairs, and everywhere, every which way but loose.
Everywhere else, yep. So,
yeah. Consummate professionals, you could call
them. So Tom Crib, he fights because his wiener's small.
Either way, Crib wins the fight, and they're writing all articles in the paper. He's a national hero. We knew it. Crib was gonna win. This American guy, this former slave, had no chance. Britain reigns supreme, and that's that. But there was a huge crowd there, and people knew what went down, and there was a public outcry, and they said, which I agree with, I don't know if you do, but that Molineaux was robbed. He won the fight twice and the crowd robbed him. So he basically cheated his way to victory.
Yeah, it's such typical fucking bullshit for back then. It's so fucked up. Yeah.
So people were upset about it and they demanded a rematch, which I think is only fair. I mean, it's, you know, that's not the way the fight really went down. He cheated his way to victory.
Bunch of bullshit. So that's that fight. It's on record as Tom Crib fucking winning, unfortunately.
Yep. 35 rounds, though. Jesus Christ, is that a long fight?
18 December, 1810, Copthorne Gap, Surrey, wherever that is.
Surrey.
So the next fight, I didn't find the actual story, but I do know that his last name is funny.
Yeah, I'll tell you the story, but please introduce the fight.
All right, on the left-hand corner here, we have Tom Molineaux. On the right side of the ring, we got William Rimmer.
Ding, ding, ding.
Thank you for coming here to Molseyhurst, England, just outside of London.
William Worcestershire Rimmer. Upon Worcestershire upon Oxfordshire in Molseyhurst
is in West Molsey, Surrey, on the south bank of the River Thames, above Molsey Lock.
Of course, it is.
Oldest sporting venues and was used in the 18th and 19th centuries for cricket, prize fighting, rim jobs, and other sports. William Bill Rimmer.
Rimmer.
This is Tom Molineaux.
Yeah, I didn't know it was a place for cricket too, but yeah, prize fighting is definitely one of the fights.
Yeah, exactly. I need a quick commercial break.
And sure.
Then we'll go back and do William Rimjob Rimmer, and we'll pick it up from there.
You got it, man. Pick up with Rimmer before the commercial break went to Rimmer.
Yeah, is there a difference between getting a Rimmer also as a rim job or tossing a salad? It's the same thing, right?
It's the same thing.
Yeah. Okay.
We're getting a lot of sex education out of the way on this podcast. We're doing the Lord's work.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree. So I'm glad if anyone didn't know that.
Last week we talked about bottoms and tops, and this week we're talking about tops and bottom.
Yeah, we're all figuring something out today. So, a rimmer is also known as on Urban Dictionary. It says to pack a bowl with so much marijuana that it's high as the rim of the bowl piece or higher. That's also known as a rimmer.
Oh, okay, that's another exciting thing.
Yeah. Also, a rimmer is also known as someone who gives rim jobs.
Okay, now that sounds more like what I'm used to. I mean, I haven't never heard of the marijuana one. I'm saying.
Yeah. Yeah. No, there's actually, if you go on Urban Dictionary, there's a couple things on here. One of them has four definitions. One of them is someone who licks someone's asshole.
Okay, that tracks.
Two is someone who figuratively licks someone's ass, sucking up. In a sentence, she reckons he's a rimmer.
Like a brown noser, as they call him.
Yeah, pretty much. Another one is rimmer, tickling the anus with your tongue. Is based on the word reamer, which is an object that shapes holes.
That's stupid. That's one of those like fake word things where it's like, yeah, it's actually because of that. It's like, well, yeah, but also the rim. It's like, it's still, I mean, come on. It's still the rim, right? That's why they call it that.
Yeah, there's, yeah.
I mean, that could still be true, but I hate those like classic word definitions where like, you know, actually it's because the Earl of Rim did it first. Like, yeah, but also it's, literally going around the rim. That's why they call it that. There's no denying that's why it's called rim. it's the circle that's the circumference of like a rim on a car, a rim on a glass, a rim job.
Yeah.
It's the rim. That's what it is. I don't care if it is a reamer. That could be also true, but it's the rim. It's on the rim.
Well, I think so. Yeah, I agree. But I think a really good definition is. One who enjoys giving rim jobs so much that they perform them for no charge, in the privacy of their own home. That's a rimmer.
That's a selfless hero in my book.
Yeah. Holding up society by
no
by
charge. God, yep. I love it.
Yep. There's a bunch of different rimgasms. There's a lot of things going on here with the word rimmer. So but the whole point is that I guess everyone's getting off topic here is that
people are definitely getting off.
So the whole point is that wow, man, they just get more, you know. No one has ever said this in the history of podcasts, and I'll be the first to do it, and I just have to be honest with everyone, is that when you go on Google and you type in a search term, after three or four different first searches, it's all garbage.
Yeah, it's trash at that point.
Urban Dictionary, not the case at all.
Keeps getting better.
Yeah. It's now we're into Rimmer Fredette, which is on page like 7 after typing in just Rimmer. Is when a person with an unusually large, long tongue licks, penetrates another person's butthole without their lips touching the anus.
Wow.
And is also known as a long range rim job. And, you know, and it says in a sentence, if you were to, just so you can really know what it means.
Yeah. Can you use it in a sentence?
Yeah. In a sentence. Yeah. Actually, yeah. Actually, this is from, this was submitted by Rim Jim Salabim in May 27th, 2011. He said, "I was watching the BYU game while Gene Simmons gave me a rimmer for that."
Yeah, because he has a long tongue.
Rim job. And that's what this is. And I'm going to end this conversation right there, because that's all we need to know about. We know what rimmer means.
Once you hit the peak, there's nowhere to go but down.
Yeah, I'm sure. Actually, the thing is, like I said, Google, 3 or 4 searches later, it's all garbage. If I were to continue on, it would just probably keep getting better.
It's the opposite of diminishing return.
So we're down to the 21st of May, 1811, with William Rimmer.
Rimmer, the guy who inspired the entire conversation.
Yep, William Rimmer, versus Tom Molineaux at the Thistleton Gap.
Oh, he was at Mosley Hurst.
I'm sorry, Mosley Hurst. Sorry, I can't.
They're all just grassy knolls by the side rivers.
Yeah, I don't spreadsheets I look at too much, so I just get confused. So it was, yes, sorry, Mosley Hurst.
Yep. So Tom Molineaux. Yeah, it goes 21 rounds, which is another long fight, but as I said at the time, not that long of a fight. As the crowd said in the history books, for whatever facts or truth as we can find in there, he beat the shit out of him. After losing the crib, he goes in to Molesley Hurst, about 6 months later, beats the ever loving shit out of Rimmer, and he becomes the only man in England who's boxing who's a feared fighter. I mean, no one wants to fight him, which kind of is like what happened to Thomas Cribb back in the day, where he retired because no one would fight him. Now Molineaux is the guy no one wants to fight. They saw him go 35 rounds against the all-time champ, and they know he won. Some people refuse to believe it, but they know he did. And then he beats William Rimmer handily. He uses his hand to beat the rim.
Yep.
He's playing above the rim like Michael Jordan. And now people don't want to fight him. So his only hope now, as far as his fighting career goes, is to get a new fight. And who wants to fight him? Nobody. All his money he's spending on living La Vida Loca, booze, prostitutes, whatever. He's actually getting money borrowed from Richmond. He's lending him money just to keep afloat, because he's just spending it as soon as he can get it. And he'd be fine if he kept fighting, but no one wants to fight him. So now he's not earning any money. He didn't have a trade. He's just out there getting drunk and knocking people out in England, which at the time, not abnormal, totally legal. Now, not abnormal. Not legal, but still about as normal as it was at the time, as far as I understand. And he calls out Cribb. This is the only chance. He has to fight Cribb. No one else is going to fight him. Cribb will fight him again. The whole nation wants a rematch, besides probably the government, which is okay with him being the champion. But he writes an article in the paper. It's like an early Twitter post to call him out. And he goes, "I'm the champion of England. No one else will challenge me. Thomas Cribb doesn't challenge me, then I'm the champ. That's it. I'm the former slave from America, and I'm the new England champion." And they can't have that. So they decide to set up the fight. It's going to be in September of that year. So we got May, June, July, August, September. So less than 4 months between him fighting Rimmer and having his rematch against Thomas Cribb. Now, Thomas Cribb goes up to Scotland, and he begins another round of training with Captain Crunch, that guy who talked about the legendary pedestrian, his trainer.
That's legend.
And now people know about boxing and fighting in general that conditioning is half the battle. If you can't have the stamina to make it all 10 rounds in a boxing match, then you can't even step into the squared circle. But now take that and put it in the time where there's no limits of rounds. You can go 30 rounds. Stamina is even more important. It's all about how long you can last. If you can take the punch, if you can be the bottom, We get it. But you have to be able to stick and move and keep fighting. And Thomas Cribb dedicates himself the next 3 months to building up that stamina. I can only imagine he's taking punches, he's throwing punches, and he's probably walking hundreds of miles with that Scottish pedestrian himself, just getting that stamina in. It's a marathon, not a sprint.
Yeah, absolutely. He probably said, so if I were to probably just recap the way this goes, is our boy Tom Cribb said, "Hey, Captain Crunch.
Oi,
our boy Tom Molineaux beat William Rimmer." And then Captain Crunch said to him, "All right, let me take you to the mountains, my boy." They went to the mountains just like Christian Bale did in The Dark Knight. They just went up like there. They
fucking like Rocky and Rocky IV.
Yeah, oh, Rocky IV, Dark Knight.
Dirty Dancing.
Yeah. All I don't even need to say anymore. But those three movies combined was like Tom Cribb going up there and training for weeks on end to go beat Tom Molineaux in the same face, because he knew that William Rimmer,
the Rim Boy,
famous for inventing the term Rimmer on Urban Dictionary, was defeated at mostly hissed.
That's right. And
he cannot lose this fucking fight. So he went up there.
Exactly. England is still resting on his shoulders even now.
Exactly. And William Rimmer trained. Sorry, not William Rimmer. Sorry, Tom.
No, Rimmer's done.
Yeah, William Rimmer is out the fucking, out the ass.
He's a footnote in history that's more famous for a sexual act than his real name now.
Yeah. Well, that's true.
It's a shame.
So, Tom Cribb, he might have invented it just like cuck. I mean, a lot of words here.
Yeah.
A lot of things invented because of Tom Molineaux beating people's ass and like pounding their ass with fucking hammer
down. Hard. He's pounding those bottoms hard.
Yeah, big time after slaying all the British chicks. Super good opportunity.
Legendary. But
William Rimmer lost his match in 21st of May. Mm-hmm. And then Tom Molineaux didn't fight Tom Cribb again for another June, July,
just did
August,
it.
September, 4 months later. So, so Tom Cribb had 4 months to go train the mountains with Mr. Miyagi to go beat Tom Molineaux. So Joe, let's pick it up in September 28th.
And in the meantime, Tom Molineaux had just been in a fight, and Cribb hadn't fought since their last fight. So he was all rested up and recovered. And Molineaux, like you said, only 4 months away, he just had another fight. And how does he spend his time training? Cribb is up in the highlands of Scotland doing pedestrian walks. And Molineaux is where he likes to be.
Ass licked out by a bunch of British chicks.
Exactly. He's not training at all. Richmond is pissed because Richmond knows how he should have won the last match. And he has the inborn talent, but not the motivation and not the skill set to actually, if he used Richmond's method of fighting and he had his physique, he's convinced he'd beat Cribb no problem. That would be it. It'd be over.
Yeah.
But he decides to, keep drinking, keep whoring around, you know, spending time with, you know, all kinds of the British chicks that are all about him, which, you know, I'm not knocking him for it, but if you want to win a fight for the world championship of bare knuckle boxing, now is not the time to be drinking booze and staple ladies.
Maybe one of my ancestors was his trainer and said, "Dude, be confident, be a leader, go fucking slay, drink beef eater." That's
yeah, exactly. And don't be a cuck, which he could learn from his Mr.
Miyagi. The only rule is, no matter how hungover you are or how much your butthole gets hurt from getting rim jobs from all the hot British chicks here,
show up for
practice in the morning.
You got to show up. And he wasn't showing up for practice. Showing up late. He wasn't showing up at all. It was terrible.
But no one knows this. Hangovers, dude, I've powered through a lot of them. And that's serious strength. It's almost the same thing as being a rimmer. No, a bottom.
It's like being a bottom. It takes mental will.
Doesn't matter. Show up. You'll get through it. It'll be hard, but you'll get through this. So if you go out and your thing is horse because it's the 1800s, totally cool. No judgment. All fine.
Just you got to show up on game day, though.
The fucking ring, whatever they call it in dodgeball. in the morning, time for fucking practice. Don't skip practice or else I'm gonna come there and fucking blow the frame off your fucking rim. And you know, that's what I would do as a coach.
Those lug nuts out.
Yeah. Yep. Yep.
And yeah, unfortunately for us, the hero of our story, Tom Molineaux, did not take that advice. He didn't show up. He didn't practice. And Crib did. And even though Crib is now much older than Molineaux, because let's not forget, he fought Molineaux's trainer. So he's been around for quite some time. He's been retired twice.
Oh, yeah, guys. Yep.
He's coming out of retirement again, and he's putting in the work. And they show up for that fight in Thistleton Gap, which is what you can see behind me here, an artist rendition of what happened there.
Thistleton Gap.
And it was 28th September, the rematch, Crib versus Molineaux.
Yep.
And to prepare for the fight, we've already mentioned what Crib did. And the day of the fight, Molineaux's preparation was to drink a tall glass of beer and eat an entire apple pie, which
I get that.
At the time, I can see there's some debate, but now that we know about fight science and nutrition, probably not the best way to prepare for a heavyweight bout is to drink a tall glass of beer and eat an entire apple pie. But, you know, who am I to say?
Yeah, and for those of you who don't know where the Thistleton Gap is, if you've ever flown,
and most people do know, but please, for the people who don't, let's, you know, at least mention it.
If you've ever flown into Heathrow Airport where the Concorde used to land, it's fucking nowhere near there, and that's all you need to know.
It's by a body of water somewhere in England.
It says it's in the most northerly village in the county of Rutland, which is a civil parish, and no one knows what that means. In the East Midlands of England, sounds like a desert, but it's not. So
East Midlands.
The population of the village at the 2001 census was 99.
Wow. So it's in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah. It's pretty much where they make scotch in Scotland, but it's in England.
Yeah.
The best way to describe where Thistleton is.
The Thistleton Gap.
So Tom Molineaux, no.
It's Tom versus Tom again.
Yep, Tom versus Tom, and no William Rimmer this time.
No Rimmers.
No Rimmers.
Only bottoms.
Yep, no cucks, no Rimmers. Only one bottom.
Only one bottom, exactly.
One fight, one opportunity, one chance to make it happen.
One smoke, one shot, one bear. And there it is. There's the fight. It's the rematch that the country's been clamoring for. Richmond is hoping that this will be his comeback, his new student that should have won last time. This is the rematch we've been waiting for. I mean, Crib's getting older. Molineaux should have won last time. And then hopefully this time, because of the controversy last time, they won't let the crowd come in and attack the fighters during the match. But unfortunately, you got to show up.
Molineaux
didn't show up in only 11 rounds, which would be a record for heavyweight fights nowadays. At the time, it's barely anything. Molineaux's throwing punches in the first couple rounds, but Crib has spent his time with Captain Crunch learning how to have some stamina, and he's taking it seriously.
Yeah.
And he, as you can see behind me here, that's Crib throwing the haymaker on Molineaux there, and Molineaux loses the fight. This time, it's not up for debate. Molineaux lost handily.
Huge bummer.
Yeah.
Yep.
That American freed slave who was the pride of Richmond. Ironically, not Richmond, Virginia. He's from Virginia. But yeah, he lost the fight. And Tom Crib is still the champion of England. And the English people couldn't have been more happy about it. And that more or less ends the tale. The exciting and thrilling and sad tale of Tom Molineaux. He went on to continue to fight because that's the only way he can make money. The only way he can make money is to keep fighting. So although Richmond wasn't as keen on having him as a student after that, he was still an associate of his. So instead of being promoted by Richmond, Molineaux goes on to roam the countryside of Northern England and Ireland, obviously drinking himself along the way and letting the ladies know who's in town, but still fighting. Dylan, do you want to fill us in on his final fights of his career?
Yeah, you got two more fights in his career on document. So he went 5-3-1 still a good record. And back then,
for sure,
this is not like a every week thing. This is a every 6 months, if not every once a year thing. So
also, there's no such thing as sparring. There's no training fights. Yeah. When you fight, you're fighting.
Fucking that's up. It.
And he's fighting on is off the clock, as it were, at bars, on the street, wherever.
Yeah, he's just like Spider-Man's dad. So
just like Spider-Man's dad. I don't know what that means, but I agree with you.
The first Spider-Man that came out in 2001, where Dashboard Confessional had that song, that one.
Yeah, but Spider-Man's dad didn't fight, though, because his dad...
No, his dad was a boxer, and he got shot in the street, remember? In the first good Spider-Man movie.
Oh, Uncle Ben... His uncle.
Sorry, Uncle Ben.
Yeah. I hear you saying that. We spread that circle. Yeah,
that was Queens, and he was a fighter. He got shot, fucking whatever.
Yep. Yeah, the man spider, they called him.
Yeah. Yeah. There we go.
Bone saws ready. R.I.P. Macho Man Randy Savage. Sorry, go ahead.
So the next fight didn't happen until 2 years later, and it was in the April 2nd, 1813. And it was a fight against Jack Carter, went 25 rounds. And I promise you that we're the only podcast that has ever fucking existed that can pronounce the location, because we're from fucking Massachusetts, and fuck you. So yeah. Anyone else who's from Ohio or
fucking, I mean, all of New England LA, is just weird English LA names,
or Texas or wherever they fucking are. No one knows the location except for me and Joe. So we're going to tell you right now. Jack Carter, April 2nd, 1813, in Remington
Gloucestershire. That's right.
Yeah, exactly. Don't else to say, because I've heard
Gloucestershire.
I'm going to go Gloucestershire. You know, no, it's Gloucestershire. Guess who won? Our fucking boy, Tom Molineaux.
Molineaux's back 25 rounds in, and he wins the fight.
25 rounds. Not,
I mean, he's not training any harder, but he hasn't given up. He can still fight.
He's still slaying. He's still getting rim jobs from chicks. He's still drinking.
He's still in the bottle
with some Newcastle, whatever they fucking had back then. And so the next two fights were against the same guy, William, aka Bill Fuller.
Not to be confused with Will Rimmer. This is Will Fuller.
True. Yeah.
Fuller House.
Yep.
R.I.P. Bob Saget.
Will or Bill Fuller, instead of being full of rim jobs, he was full of shit because he kept getting. fucking loser fest.
I don't even know how they draw in the first one. It's a very short match, even for modern day boxing. It was only four rounds, the draw.
Well, I can tell you how. It could have been a tornado, earthquake, tsunami.
Active gad.
Active shooter.
Imagine an active shooter back then. They have to reload the musket. They're like, you guys better start running.
Yeah, somebody's gonna ship us boxing around. Could have been.
It's like, my mom doesn't understand me because when I was born, she died. But I still hate the world, and I must go to my local schoolhouse and fire a musket ball up into the sister.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly probably what happened, Joe. So all of that, or maybe even the boxing ring, the floor fell through because fucking William Rimmer, fucking fat balls were too heavy. I don't know, but like,
who knows?
This was, so the first one was in May 27th.
Yeah. So you have to imagine that they called a draw because there's something stopped the fight because only 3 days later, they have another fight with the same people. So I actually wouldn't even count the draw. I would take that out of their record if it was me. But unfortunately, I'm not the knuckle boxing representative. But I would say his record shouldn't even say the draw, because the draw shouldn't be counted. It should be disqualified. Because here's the next fight.
Yeah, well, exactly. So the next fight, same thing. William Bill Fuller, like I said, 5 days later, 4 days later. At Auschenau, which is the first town I've ever heard of that sounds like Auschwitz, that isn't. No, literally, there's no town ever in the world that starts with Osh. Name one, Joe.
Auschwitz.
Well, it's not a town. Auschwitz was a horrible fucking concentration camp. But I've never heard of a town that actually starts with Osh.
Oh, Australia.
It's spelled differently, though.
No, you're totally right. There's nothing else. That's the only one.
A-U-C-H-I-N-E-U-X. Oshinau. Oshinau.
Austria.
It was like a, yeah, but Austria, same thing. There's no C-H. Auschwitz.
Yeah. No, it's yeah, Auschwitz and Oshinau are the only ones.
Yeah, so fucked up. So anyway, so as expected, Tom Molineaux beats the fucking rim job out of this fucking guy
in the shortest boxing match, yeah, not only of his career but any bare knuckle boxing I looked into time. It's the shortest one maybe of all time. Two rounds.
Yeah,
beats him in two rounds after a draw, which makes me think that William Fuller is kind of a bitch and he was kind of like waiting to draw it out, but really,
yeah, he got
a draw. Waiting 4 days and then two rounds in you already lose. I mean, you're already gonna lose.
For all we know, he claimed that in 1814 he they're in a fight. He already knows he's getting his fucking shit beat out. Like some of our friends we grew up with who like are just bad losers. And they go, whoa, there's an asteroid coming. And you go, what? And they have to draw the round because no one knows shit back then.
Oh, my mom's calling me. I got to go home. This doesn't count.
Oh, yeah, this doesn't count. Sorry, I got to go. And then you're like, all right, well, I'll see you in a few days. And then you go there and you go, this kid can't bitch out right now. And you just go pound his fucking ass in.
And he did.
And he fucking did. Two rounds. That is literally like, a 18-year-old versus a 12-year-old. Like, let's just fucking
over
this fucking guy.
Yeah, and not like he went down by TKO. I mean, he went down like the rules we're talking about. He got his ass kicked so he couldn't fight anymore. He had to give up. That's it.
Yeah. Yep. So that guy sucks. About a year later, our boy Tom Molineaux, fucking heavyweight, fucking kick-ass dude, decides to fight a guy named George Cooper. Sounds pretty, like a George Cooper. You can kind of picture this guy. At Clifton Hill, Lanarkshire. I haven't been there.
Lancashire, I think it's called, or Lancashire.
No, right? It's late. L-A-N.
Oh, it's it is. It is Lanarkshire.
Yep. Lanarkshire. In another respectable, on average, bare knuckle, fucking beat ass.
Ding, ding.
George Cooper. And I don't have any details on this. It could have been a very round one Tom Cribb fucking bitch ass pussy fight where George Cooper pussed out and, the crowd came in and beat the shit of our friend Tom. We don't know, but I imagine that a lot of these losses could have probably possibly been.
It's hard to say. Yeah. Cause unfortunately we only have the records that people wrote in papers and things at the time, because there's no obviously recording of it, or there's no sports entity that like records records. I mean, this is all historians having to go and tear through primary documents and then be like, oh, what's the record? Like, we only know the records of these boxers because of the fact that historians went and looked back at these diaries and letters. It wasn't like there's the bare knuckle boxing NFL that has like, oh yeah, here's Tom Molineaux's record. Like, you had to, it's only retroactively you look at it and be like, okay, this is what happened. So it's all very hazy. You kind of have to trust the material at the time.
Yeah, that's it. History was written by the victors. And back then it was the fucking white people who didn't want to look bad.
Exactly.
So this dude was a fucking badass. I mean, it was fucking awesome. So that's his fighting career. It really only lasts like 5 years besides bar fights.
Mm-hmm. You know, the strongest fires, they burn the brightest, but they last the shortest.
It's fucking true, man. We've all pouring gasoline on fires. He's the gasoline. So
he's the gasoline.
His prize fighting career ended in 1815. However, he decided to just keep doing sparring and exhibitions, and after his visit to Scotland he toured Ireland, where he suffered tuberculosis.
Well, I heard this from another podcast, so I need to cite my source, but it's a good point. No one ever went to Ireland to get sober, so he didn't stop drinking when he went to Ireland.
Yeah, that's a fact. Yep. So yep, that's something that happened. And it says he was in a debtor's prison. Somebody he owed money. Is a prison?
Yeah, he owed money to Richmond.
Yeah.
He borrowed all that money from Richmond and he never paid them back.
I get that. No problem with that. And then after that, he became, just like you said, increasingly dependent on alcohol.
Yeah. And I mean, he was a young man too.
He was 34 years old.
34 when he was being taken care of in Galway, Ireland. He made it at least to Galway, which is probably like as closest to a bullseye you can get. I know that, that's more of west, either way. West of Limerick. He hits Galway and he goes, oh, I'm going to keep drinking and fighting people at bars. And he gets taken care of by Galway's 77th Regiment, which is a military regiment. And yep. There's three black soldiers who are living there, and they take him in because they know who he is and they see he's on hard times. And they let him live in a storage closet or a broom closet to stay in.
Man, it's never got easier for this guy. He had a good reign of like fame and then lives in a storage closet. I mean,
that's hard way to go. And he ends up, unfortunately, passing away from it. Their spirits got to him. And he died there in the closet there. And his friends went back to see him. And he couldn't breathe three sheets of the wind. The boy, I couldn't stand it. The Lord took him up.
34 years old.
34. I can't believe it. He's a young man. So much promise. But yeah, and he died at 34.
Yeah, too young. That is fucked up. But he's, as they say in Sandlot.
Heroes are remembered. But legends never die.
Yeah,
exactly true. I mean, especially coming from a bondage and slavery to rock the world this way, we're still talking about him. He struck fear in the hearts of the most powerful empire in the world. They couldn't stand the idea of him beating their champion. And he did beat him. They just cheated to win. And the second time he did lose, but I can hardly blame the guy for having a crazy, weird life. But after that, Richmond continued on, and he was like the example of the first Tom Molineaux. He didn't have the physical talents, but he had the mental talents and the skills. And he fought until he was 55 years old, culminating in a record of 7-2, I believe. So Richmond, who lost to Tom Cribb, ended up being 17-2. I'm sorry. He had 17 wins and two losses in his career. I mean,
that's a good fucking... a good number,
and he was fighting well into his 50s against these young guys who didn't know how to bottom, you know.
Yeah,
and not only did he continue to foster new fighters, he actually ended up becoming good friends with none other than Thomas Cribb. They got later in life, it's almost like the enemies that fight and they cut their teeth in the arena, and as they get older, the respect for each other grows, and they ended up being very good friends, and Tom Cribb bought his own pub, much like Richmond already had his.
Still there,
Tom
there. Cribb
started doing the same thing, and they were friends until later life. And I would never picture this going into the story, but Bill Richmond actually died in Tom Cribb's bar. That's how good of friends they were. It wasn't a freak accident. That's where he lived half the time, and he happened to die there. So Bill Richmond, who started our story, his arch rival, Tom Cribb, who was put up against his Daniel San, his Karate Kid, and they end up being great friends. And Thomas Cribb obviously spoke at his funeral. He thought he was a great guy and definitely one of the most important people when it comes not only to bare knuckle boxing, but being a precursor to the boxing we know today.
A legend. Like a great life. You die at your best friend's bar, man. That's fucking cool.
Absolutely.
Nothing wrong with that.
That's about it.
So that's it, folks. That's the most badass boxer that ever lived. Tom Molineaux started off a slave in Virginia, a shithole back then, and made his way, and then also took a fucking boat to England and blew people's fucking frames off their assholes.
He was a real rimmer.
A real rimmer. Breaking that rim right out of the frame.
And there was a bare knuckle boxing hall of fame that was established in Belfast, New York. It was established in 2009, so we were juniors in high school and this thing was established. But you better believe who's in it. Not only Tom Molineaux, but Bill Richmond and Thomas Cribb, they're all in it, and with good reason.
Yeah, with good reason. And they didn't allow Bill Rimmer in, or Tom Rimmer, whatever his name is.
Rimmer didn't make the cut.
He didn't make the cut because he was...
He was uncut.
He was uncut. Some people are all nets, some people are just hitting the rim. He was hitting the rim. So,
Rick. Final thoughts?
Yeah, final thoughts.
This will be cut. This will part will be cut.
You go first.
My final thoughts on Tom Molineaux. I think it's a really cool story. I love the idea of, first of all, everyone loves a good underdog story, but this is beyond underdog. The guy pulled himself up by his bootstraps times a million. I mean, the amount of gumption you don't only just have to travel overseas with no money, hoping that, like, I heard about this guy, I'm pretty sure. I mean, if I don't text somebody three times before I go on a date, I feel like they're not showing up. And this guy was taking a ship overseas on the hearsay of people he trusted to make a career on punching people in the face and getting punched. I mean, it takes a lot of guts and a lot of gumption. Never mind the fact that you're a party hard, former slave from America, and British society is not too happy to have that as part of it. So I think that the guy faced a lot of uphill battles, and him and Richmond really show that even when the whole world's turned against you, if you can fight that hard and be that smart, you can kick their ass and you can show everybody that you're made of some stronger stuff than they are. And I think it's worth mentioning even now, about 200 years later.
Hell yeah. My only thoughts are, I just wish that I knew his thoughts when he was chilling on the side of that boat, which is probably made of wood with some sails, and going, I'm going to spend the next 90 days hanging on the side of his boat because I'm going to go beat the shit out of a bunch of white British dudes.
Love the idea of getting there and having a...
Yep, the only reason I'm doing this is because I'm just going to go there and beat the shit out of people. Like, just
for money.
Your purpose is to
just... I love him calling out people at the time, too. Just being the most baddest guy in town, just having a nice, pretty white girl on your arm, or walking down the street and being like, what are you going to do? What the fuck are you going to do? And they're like, yeah, we can't do shit.
Asshole. Cool. Come talk to me about it. And they go, and he goes, okay, cool. Yeah. All right, cool.
He almost has talked shit about him every day of his life. And he's fought back.
He goes, yeah.
Respect.
I'm gonna fuck you up.
Give the 1-2 punch there. I'll give you the hammer fist on top of your head there, buddy bastard.
Just smoke him with his Virginia Southern accent. Just
smoke him like a Virginia Slim.
Donkey Kong it. That's it. So my final thoughts are, this dude's a fucking awesome guy. Huge fan of him. Glad this shit still happened. Paving the way for getting through the Civil War on the right side of things and then continuing on with that movement.
For sure.
Today, through George Floyd, this guy's fucking kicking serious rims. And that's all I gotta say. Love it.
Kicking rims, taking trophies.
That's it, man. So that's the Dylan Joe Basin podcast, episode 46.
46.
But we're just getting started. We're just getting our feet.
We're just hitting our stride here, folks.
We're just getting our feet wet. You hang tight. We are Zoom for like right now, but very, very soon we're just going to be live again, doing our fucking thing. Next week, we do have a interesting episode planned before. Should we spell a secret about February so everyone can look forward to our February episodes? I'm going to do it because I don't care. February is cult month.
Cold.
Whole entire episode of Dylan Joe Basin podcast, 4 episodes in a row, or whatever. February is a weird month, but probably 4, 3, I don't know, whatever it is.
Cults. 3 and change. Yeah, we're doing exactly teams. Right.
Cult.
We did a spooky February. Month in October. We're doing the cult month in February. I've been wanting to do an episode about cults forever, and Dylan came up with the idea of not just doing one episode of it because it's too much there. It's too much meaty content. We got to break it up, man. Colts, so we're going to do it.
Colts cover aliens, UFOs, drugs, sex, rim jobs, fucking boxing.
You name it.
Dude, all you of name it. Everything we've ever talked about. I can't think of one topic we've ever talked about that doesn't involve a cult. It's all
covered. It's all there.
So we're going to devote a whole entire month, you guys, for Colts. Cult month.
February 2022,
cult month. Bring it on. It's a good time. Next week's episode, we're planning to have a special guest. We'll let you know. Sometimes they get diarrhea or get...
Yeah, sorry. Our guest this week, he had severe diarrhea and his catalytic converter got stolen.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? You live life the way you can, but hopefully she'll show up next time and we'll talk about him. We'll talk to him, rather, about the next topic.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And if he wants to join next week's episode with another guest, another hot guest again, so see what happens.
Hell yeah. And that's why they call it the basement.
Basement. Anything happens, things allowed. No one tells secrets in the basement. No stitches here. And so far...
It ain't over till you give up or you get knocked up, mate. And I'm a good bottom. I can take it. I'm a glutton for punishment. You heard.
That's it. Don't go. Basement Podcast, episode 46. Go fuck yourself.
Put up your dukes, fuckers.
So many places you can just up under the armpit. That's a place I've been punched. That's always
that makes you shit your pants. We all know that.
It does. Fact. Yeah. Never shit my pants that, but I've been punched.
You know the armpit. They shit their pants. That's
good
true.
Spot to get fucking hit. And William Rimmer trained. Sorry, not William Rimmer. Sorry, Tom.
No, Rimmer's done.
Rimmer is out the ass.
Don't fuck with him.
Yeah. It's awesome. Yeah, I think that they call them shit brick houses now.
Brick shit houses. Yeah.
Yeah, we're not talking about the chicken house. Don't get confused.
Yeah. He's a brick shit house. He's building a brick shit house, and that's for sure.
Brick shit house for sure. He's a piece of toast with some beans on it.
And he was like, "Blimey, that's me all I ever saw."
Blimey, jerk me off 6 ways from Saturday. Ain't no bar.
Oh, but he was Scottish though, so he was like, "I can't believe it, laddie. Just what I needed in this cold, foggy morning."
Exactly.
A slice of toast and some beans. You know I'm a legendary pedestrian, don't you, lad?
Dude, was that him? I feel like that was just a cut-in of him speaking.
Oh, yeah, it was.
And as you mentioned earlier, if just one of them decided to punch the other one in the armpit, they'd shit.
And the fight would be over.
Too. It's a fact. Go punch. Yeah, if you're listening to the podcast, punch who's ever next to you in the car in the armpit. So
in the armpit. Get them to put their hands up and then just punch them as hard as you can in the armpit. They will shit.
Tell me, say, hey, I've got a game. Everyone's gonna put their arms up in the air real quick, and whoever does longest wins immediately punch me on the head.
Yep, and then they will shit, and it will be hilarious.
Yeah, it's the only way to figure this out. That was a thing that was happening back then all the time.
Oh yeah. Yeah, because that's why they would stand like this and have their armpits closed and have their fists close to their body, because if they put their arms up to guard their face, boom, right in the armpit, you shit your pants, fight's over.
Yeah, and then you get scared, and then you go, oh, I made a mistake, and then they beat the shit out of you.
Because
they made you shit.
Yeah, they beat the shit out of your trousers, and then all you have is pants.
Yeah, you could barely stand in line at a coffee shop back then and have someone not do that to you.
If you were in a coffee shop in the year 1805 and they said, whose meal is this, and you put your hand up, you would get punched in the armpit and you would shit in public.
Yeah, it happened so much. It just wasn't documented as much because the church documented most
things. Well, it's embarrassing. People wouldn't admit it.
Much.
Right, exactly. Yeah, so you don't hear about it a lot. But, I mean, if you need any more proof that it happened, go ahead, have your friend raise their hand. Ask them a question that's really easy and go class dismissed and then punch them in the armpit as hard as you can. And then you tell me what you smell. You know what I mean?
Yeah, hear, smell, see, whatever.
Yeah, hear me now, smell it later. You know what I mean? Don't take my word for it. Read a rainbow.
Don't be embarrassed to have it see what happened. It's happened to the best of us.
And don't do it to yourself. It's like tickling yourself. You can't. That's not how it works. You have to do it to someone else.
Yeah.
I know you're getting all cute with us here. Oh, I'll do it to myself. You won't hit hard enough. Yeah, you won't. Do it to someone else and do it as hard as you can. They will shit their pants.
Yep.
And then who's laughing all the way to the fucking changing station? You are. That's who.
Yeah.